This week, we're on the John Day River in Oregon, bobber fishing for steelhead with guide Dave Maroon. But first, we're winter steelhead fishing Washington's Cowlitz River with guide Steve Leonard on one of the world's most productive hatchery steelhead rivers. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. It's a long time before first light on the Cowlitz River, but steelhead don't need much light to find your bait, especially if it's UV enhanced.
Yeah, I love steelhead fishing.
Oh, man.
Close.
Close.
I put that water-soluble tool out here.
Today, we're fishing with guide Steve Leonard, the Cowlitz River Hatchery Steelhead, which nearly all come from the Blue Creek Hatchery, which has created a viable, nearly year-round steelhead fishery.
Good morning on the Cowlitz River.
On the Cowlitz.
Yeah. Beats working any day, huh?
The early morning bite is on as Phil Perrone of Procure has our second hookup. For bait, everyone is using roe or Oregon tackle steely bugs soaked in Procure's water-soluble scent. And it looks like bloody tuna is the right one for this morning.
Steelhead?
We're fishing a run here just below the hatchery. These fish are coming up. It's the upper part of the river, and they're staging here to go into the hatchery. It's a nice drift down through here. We're getting to the bottom end of it right now. But these fish are tucked up along the shore here, so we're kind of trying to concentrate in that area as we're drifting down through here.
We're side drifting our baits, which means we can achieve very long drifts. And as long as we're using the right amount of weight,
we're gonna go run another little slot that's a little bit deep in water, so we're gonna go to a three ball sink instead of a two.
We know that our baits will be right where they need to be.
That's a fish getting the son of a gun there.
There's also great bank access on the Cowlitz. But don't forget your net.
I hope you're enjoying this episode from way back when on the Cowlitz River. Now we're going to go back to the Cowlitz River, and then we're going to the John Day River for some really interesting and fantastic steelhead fishing. But before that, Steve Leonard's going to be in studio discussing some of the changes and what's happened with the Cowlitz River since this episode was filmed. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to the Cowlitz River. I'm Justin Wolf. The Cowlitz has been fishing great this year, but with below average rainfall, the flows out of the dam were just cut back last night, which usually means tough fishing for a few days. So we're glad to have two fish in the boat long before sunrise. A key to successful drift fishing is using just the right amount of weight. Too little weight and the fish won't see your bait. Too much weight and you'll get snagged, which still happens even with the right amount of weight, but at least you get to pretend that you have a fish on.
Hate when that happens. Today we're using the slinkies, and the easiest way to do this is like with the Oregon Tackle slinky making kit. This one here has the four beads in it, but depending on how fast the water's moving, you can go down to, you know, one, two, or if it's a real slow drift, you can go as many as six. But this way you just pre-make up a bunch of different sizes and you're ready to go.
Get you hooked up.
Yeah, all right. This is some good service here, boy, I tell you what.
On the Cowlitz River here this year, this winter, the fishing's been really good. It's been running the water level about 9,000 cubic feet, and they dropped it down to 6,700 last night. So it makes the bite a little bit tougher due to the water dropping. Sometimes it takes a day or two for it to come back on. But so far, we've got three on today, got them all three in the boat. And overall, we're doing pretty good compared to the other boats and what we've seen for the action today. So we've got a couple right at daylight, and we just picked up one more here. It's been a couple hours since daylight, so. But overall, it's been a really good winter fishery up here. It's dam regulated, so it's been a really dry December this year, which is really unusual, which we'll take it from a wet spring, that the driftboat river's been really tough due to the low water. So this is really a good fishery. You can fish it all year round, especially in the winter time. We're using a CX high fluorescent P line. This is a 10 pound main line with an 8 pound CX moss green leader. Works really well. This P line works real good, especially the CX brand. It doesn't have a lot of memory in it, so it works really well for spinning reels. And I like the high vis, so when we're free drifting with multiple rods, you can tell where the lines are at, and for tangle ups, it eliminates a lot of that. And you can kind of control your lines by the speed of the boat, and you can get a better visual on them. So it works real well.
No rockfish this time.
I just baited that one up, put the water-soluble tuna on. Then you cast it and bang, offshoot.
Yeah.
You still got a while, but yeah, going back.
All right, we got a steelhead on here. It's gonna take us down to this rapid here. We got pulled down. It's a good looking fish, fighting pretty hard like a normal steelhead does. So I'm gonna drop down this next rapid here and see if we can get it in the net. Good one. All right.
That's a steelhead.
Woo!
Watch out for the hook in the mouth.
Yeah, we got it.
Nice steelhead there.
Okay, so what I've done, I've just got a corky with eggs, and I've got the water-soluble tuna, which just puts a ton of scent in the water very quickly. It seems to be working today, so we'll keep on going with it. Now, this morning, we are catching them on these steedy bugs, just with the tuna oil right on these. So you don't have to necessarily use bait. You can use just these steedy bugs, set them up, put them out, 18, 22 inch leader, and you'll be just fine. Come right at the boat, kind of gave me a scare.
Keep the rod tip up, keep the rod bent.
Coming back. Front of the boat, back of the boat.
Typical steelhead for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, good day.
I like it. I love that sound.
Throw that right a little bit. Get this boat under control here. Fish just don't want to cooperate. Sometimes they always want to come up underneath the boat. You got to get a position just right. We're going to get him this time. Here we go.
Yeah.
All right.
Woo.
Good one. Good job.
Thank you, sir. Hey, Steve, on these eggs, what cure were you using?
This is the wizard cure. It's the red cure. It's really good for winter fishing, any type of steelhead. Put some borax on them after I got them cured up in the wizard pro cure. Dries them out a little bit, makes them real nice and firm, and also keeps the boat a lot cleaner for when I'm the guy that has to clean the boat.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. And as you can tell, they like it. And the best part about it is this is a nice female. These winter fish have nice eggs in them. Actually, the eggs we're using today are fresh steelhead eggs I cured up. These haven't been frozen, they're fresh eggs, which really helps the bite also. It increases your chances. So Steve had done me a favor today and helped me replenish my egg supply.
Right on. Anytime, buddy.
Thank you.
Anytime.
So here we are with Steve Leonard from Steve's Guided Adventures. Now, Steve, that was a fantastic trip we had, 8, 9 years ago?
Yeah, December.
And that was when I first started to really do a lot of filming up in this part of the country, and it was amazing to see the Cowlitz River and the productivity of that river. But things have changed now. If we went out there at the same time of year now, it would be different, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah, so it's not quite the same fishery. So can you explain what's going on over the years?
So what's happened since that time is that we've had the wild genetics of fish in our tributaries in the Pacific Northwest has been kind of, I wouldn't say under attack, but they're trying to keep the population of the wild fish that we have today. And some of these other genetics of fish that we have are no wild fish. There's no genetics of wild fish. And a lot of them are what they call a chamber stock that's from the Puget Sound. And on that fishery in December on the Cowlitz River was considered an early stock, and it was chamber stock. The later run that they have for January, February is a later returning stock that originally came from the 1960s from the Cowlitz River, from the wild stock that returned to the river. And that's where that stock came from originally. So when we had that show for years prior to that, December was a phenomenal fishery for the Cowlitz River. It had bank fishermen that come from all over, northern, up in Seattle, everywhere they came. And we've seen that on the show of how many people were bank fishing that fishery. But what had happened was, is the more of the wild fish, you know, was more in danger. Mm-hmm. They did some studies from 2006 to 2011 and found out that, yeah, they're in remission and we need to protect them. And that Cowlitz River is a huge watershed for wild fish because of the size of the river and where it comes from. So they decided to just do away with the Erdi stock, which is the chamber stock, and they, which was 300,000 smolt that they would release. And then they did 350,000 of the late returning stock, which is the wild stock. Mm-hmm. And since that time, they, in 2012 was the last time that they planted the chamber stock. They bumped up the late run from 350,000 to 650,000. So they took that 300,000 Erdi stock, bumped it up with the same genetic wild stock as they did the 350 late, bumped it to 650,000. So now they're going to be returning, you know, they'll start showing up late January, but February they start showing up. I think the numbers were like 1,500 was harvested by sport fishermen in February, but then March is the premier peak month for the late returning stock. Mm-hmm. Of that original wild stock, and they say like 6,000 fish are being harvested in March, and that goes all the way into April. So there's good opportunities from January, you know, through April, mm-hmm. but there's nothing there on that Erdi starting in November to December.
Yeah, that's a shame. You know, it totally makes sense why wild fish are important and genetics and all that. But could the hatcheries help the wild fish?
Is that... And I think it is. A lot of it has to do with the permitting for these hatcheries as far as what they're allowed to release and the type of stock that they're releasing. If there's none of it, which is called the brood stock, and a lot of the Oregon rivers, they do a brood stock as part wild, part hatchery. They take some hatchery fish, they catch some wild fish and put them in a, mm-hmm. you know, an aerator box. They take them to the hatchery, they spawn them out. And the nice thing about that is that they're called biters. Mm-hmm. If the fish just shows up to the hatchery, and they spawn it out, it doesn't get caught, technically sometimes they consider that a non-biter fish. So not really great for the sport fishermen. That's how they're trying to catch that fish. So that's why they do the brood stock in Oregon, and they're implementing some of it in Washington. But the stock that they have that they're doing on that Cowlitz River is this late returning wild stock. But yes, absolutely, we need our hatcheries. And what some people don't understand, and everybody has their own, you know, their own theory behind it, but you have to have the smolts in the river system of hatcheries and wild to feed the predators. From back in those days compared to today, the predators, the cormorants, the mergansers on these fish are making their way to the ocean. These predators are preying on them. And if you don't have the numbers of this hatchery fish in the river system, the smolts of the wild are gonna be, you know, eaten up,
yeah,
you know?
I don't hear that a lot, but yeah, it's a balance.
It's a balance.
And got to make sure that if we're producing lots of fish, they've got to have a healthy environment to survive in and thrive in.
That's correct.
To come back as adults, as healthy adults.
That's correct. And in other situations, it's ocean conditions, the most important part of that smolt's life. Well, there's a couple of them. One is when they're released from the hatchery. So back to your hatchery system, a lot of it has to do with the managers running that hatchery, whether they release them when they are smolting, meaning when they get their scales, they get to the smolting stage and they're ready to go, they slowly drain the pond, they let them take off when they're ready to go. Other managers might just dump the pond, and when they're it's his theory that right now is the time and they go, they could have pneumonia type of a deal and run the marathon, they're not gonna survive.
Right.
That has a big part. And then once they hit the ocean, they say within that first week to 2 weeks when they enter the ocean is the most crucial time of their life, that if there's creel, ocean, big storms earlier that makes the bloom of the creel, and all that is a huge part of their success in the ocean, successful to survive.
Yeah, well, I sure hope we can get that fishery back the way it was, because it was really fantastic. That was one of the most really amazing experiences. And the, you know, and the legend of the Cowlitz River, you know, it's
that's just it. And that Cowlitz was the number one steelhead river in the state, and I believe it still is at different times of the year.
Yeah.
But it's more now that February, March, April, and then they have their summer return that's in July is the peak time for that July August time frame. Mm-hmm. So depending on the fishing pressure, a lot of times in this early run, guys are chasing some spring Chinook salmon in that later March and April. Good opportunity to go catch some steelhead. Typically, there's some spring Chinook to be caught on the Cowlitz River. Mm-hmm. At the same time, however, those are taking a little bit of a hurting at the moment, and it's closed this year for spring salmon, so it's catch and release if you get one.
Right. So. Well, thank you, Steve. Appreciate you coming in.
So awesome.
Now we're going to go to the John Day River, which is another the same year, which is another fantastic fishery that isn't quite the same, unfortunately. But let's go see how the steelhead fishing was a few years back on the John Day River.
We're getting an early start for some bobber fishing for Idaho-bound steelhead that have sidetracked up the John Day River, a tributary of the Columbia. Guide Dave Maroon has some ProCure-dyed prawns ready to go under the bobbers for this unique steelhead fishery.
Okay, guys, you ready here? What we're gonna do, go ahead and grab your poles there and just kind of get ready. I'm gonna let mine out first, and then I'm gonna say next two go ahead, and that'll be Doug and Steve, and you guys just plop it over and open your bail when I give you the word, and we're just gonna let these out. And ideally, you kind of wanna, you know, there's no tension on this, so you gotta flip your rod to get the line to come off your reel. So go ahead, next two.
Dave, how far are we trying to get them behind the boat?
Well, we're gonna stagger them back there a ways. You wanna get them away from the boat, you know, substantially. There's no set distance that we're doing this, but we're just separating them out a lot. You know, they're gonna be back there 100 feet, probably 150 feet at least. What's gonna happen when we get a bite here, guys, is you're gonna see it on your pole. I don't hardly ever watch the bobbers, and when the wind gets riffling on the water, you won't even be able to see your bobbers. So I tell guys, don't even worry about watching your bobbers. It's gonna be on your pole, and it's gonna be real obvious on your pole. It could be as light as something along the lines of that, or they can sometimes just come along and hammer it, okay? What you wanna do, the second you see a bite though, just pick your rod up out of the holder. Try not to pull back on it at all, though, when you pick it up out of the holder. Just slide it gently up out of the holder, hold it in a nice still position, and wait until you see the fish pulling. When you see that pull, or feel that pull, I should say, that's when you set the hook, okay? And it's gonna be very obvious. You'll feel it, it'll be very, very obvious to you. But wait for that little bit of a pull. Try not to set the hook on the little bounces. We wanna wait until they actually have it in their mouth a little bit and pull them, okay? And when you set the hook, give it a good little snap, set it pretty good, and that should be it.
How deep are you fishing your baits below your bobbers?
I'll fish these between 7 and 14 feet. Right now we're kind of shallow. We're about 8 feet, 10 feet right in there. So we have an A run and a B run of fish in here right now. The A runs are your 5 to 8 pound fish, and then the B runs tend to be 10 to 15 pounds on average. And we got a couple of, we've been getting a few of those bigger fish every day. I'd say 75, 80% of your fish are your A runs that are 5, 8 pounds, somewhere in there. And then the other 25% are your B runs. The John Day is completely undammed, no dams on the system, and no hatchers. So they, you know, not all these fish are gonna continue up the river either though. You know, right. They're gonna come into this arm and mill around and then head back to the Columbia and continue up, so.
Maybe not, oh yeah, there's there.
Okay, you're gonna have to watch that line. Phil, go ahead and go to the right of Doug there. There you go.
So we're leaving all the rods out, even though he's fighting a fish, so we're trying to get a double or a triple going. So we just try to pick the rods up and keep them out of their way. While he's fighting the fish.
Jeez.
Good hatchery.
Wow, look at that run. Jeez. Beautiful spot to catch a fish.
Yeah, it is. Beautiful day. Not too much wind. Sun's getting out. It's getting a little bit warmer. I can almost feel my feet.
Let's see what we got here. That's a wild one there. Amazing, he still has that much fight left, yeah. Huh? After all this.
This guy is just...
does not want to come
doesn't
in.
Doesn't like the program at all.
Nope. Definitely a wild one.
Oh yeah.
Wild fight.
They tug a little harder, don't they?
They do, steelhead especially.
Beautiful fish.
We're
winning!
Doesn't quite want to give up.
No. Gotta know you're just gonna let him go.
I'm gonna hold him up real quick. He'll let me grab him. There we go. Beautiful. There's the adipose fin that tells you it's a wild one.
That's a good bat. Beautiful, about 10 pounder. Pop this hook out real quick, and he'll be unharmed. Off he goes.
Welcome back to the John Day River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're fishing procured dyed ponds under bobbers for steelhead. And so far, we've caught and released a beautiful wild steelhead. The John Day also attracts hatchery steelhead out of the Columbia, which gives anglers a chance to keep a fish for dinner.
Well, thank you.
Good job.
Thank you. Boy, that was a lot of fun. Boy, they tugged pretty hard in this light tackle.
That was a fight, yeah.
Yeah, great fight.
Phil Perrone, president of Procure Bait Sense, has developed a truly water-soluble oil scent, which, when injected into the prawns, delivers an incredible burst of scent right to the fish. And today, it's working.
Now, what you saw there was the new water-soluble fish oils. Unlike regular fish oil, which kind of pelletizes and wants to float to the top, the water-soluble totally dissolves in the bait column and just puts out a massive scent right behind, right below your baits. And we've been testing it now for a year and a half and are about to release it onto the market. It's just brand new.
So we're in the John Day River fishing today, but if you notice, there's not a lot of current. It's the dam, the John Day Dam, is down in the Columbia here, and it has this backed up. So we're not actually in a river situation. There's very little current here, so we have to use the motor to move us downstream. We can't rely on the current of the river.
Oh, you got a bite, Steve. You got a bite. Wait, don't reel.
There you go. Now he's biting. Now you get him.
Got him.
There he is. Good job, Stevie.
I see him. Decent size one. Not a small one. Is it a native? Yep. Wild one.
So that's probably an unmarked hatchery fish. You can look at the dorsal and you can see all the rays are bent. The dorsal rays are bent. The fin is not, it's bent and messed up. That's probably from the hatchery, but the adipose is still there. So we do have to let that fish go. That's a beautiful fish. Another one about 9-10 pounds. Hook comes right out, right in the lip. So we're fishing real clear water here, and it's kind of important to use a fairly long leader. We're using at least 3 foot, maybe 4 foot leader. Fluorocarbon works really good. We're using some P-line fluorocarbon here. 10 or 12 pound test kind of seems to work the best. You can go a little bit lighter than that, but they're not, you know, fluorocarbon, they don't see this in the water, in this clear water, like they do normal monofilament.
This is a good sized fish.
Feels like it, huh? Get that double. Really watch that one there, Steve.
Okay.
That bobber there. What do we got?
Native.
Native. The natives are in today.
Oh, that's
here, I'll sneak in there.
All right.
She got him.
Yeah, fish on.
We got a double. Right on.
Double. You want me to reach over and get that? The second you touch
it. I just make a little run there. Listen to that line zing.
Woo, let's go for a triple.
Yeah, I've got that other rod out. So.
Whoa, you see that one jump right there? Who has that one? No one?
Yeah,
this guy's ripping.
Okay, he's going to be around that other bobber there. Yeah, he's gonna go right on it. Yeah. Be real, real fast. Yeah. You'll probably get it. There you go. Right. Perfect.
I bring him in on this side of the boat.
Oh!
Triple.
I swear this one just had a bite. I might have just, yep, it did.
Yeah, it's going down right there.
Got him!
Triple.
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 Got a triple going.
Cool.
Triple. Who wants this one?
I'll get it. I can get through.
Triple.
You found a spot, I think.
We did.
Well, we just came into this hole, and all of a sudden we've got three fish on.
Tighten that just
a hair.
Yeah, there you go. Now we don't need to have another rod in the water. They all got fish on. This is how they usually ball up in here. You find these balls of fish and it's throttle. Yep. It's another nice size one. None of these are the little 5-6 pounders at all. That's a keeper.
Let's see if he wants to come in.
That's gonna be another nice size one.
It is.
Oh yeah, look at that one. That's a big one there.
Yeah. Or it's a native fish. There he goes.
That's the biggest of the day there.
Yeah. He's fighting good. I told you I was gonna get the biggest fish today.
That'd be awesome if you guys hook up another one back there. Just your right, just a little bit there.
Native.
Is it?
Yeah.
You saw it for sure?
Yeah.
I don't believe it.
Big fish like that's got a big adipose.
Look at that thing.
Yeah, the size of that one.
That's a big fish.
For a friend, John Day, it sure is.
This side?
Yeah.
That's a hog.
Now there's a John Day fish of the day right there. That's what we come up here for. That's a beauty.
That's probably more.
We're
going to
go ahead and release this fish.
Right in the lip. There we go.
Okay, back in the water.
Give him a little revive, yeah. He's in great shape, though.
Yeah, he is.
There you go. Nice.
All right, nice one. Good job.
That was the third of the triple right there.
Yeah. Get back in the water and get another one.
Okay, thanks for watching today's episode of Angler West TV. You know, it's only with the sponsor support that the show is made possible, so please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.